Hebrews chapter 4, starting to read at verse 12. It says, "For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of the soul and of the spirit, of the joints and marrow, and discerning the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. And no creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need." This is the word of God today for the people of God. Amen. Amen. Now, over the last several weeks, we've been looking at transformation and the idea of us being transformed into the image of God, which to me means the ability for others to be able to see God in us and for us to be able to look at others and see God in them. And we discover here that God draws us on many occasions because of his word and how quick and powerful and you know, we learn here that it's sharper than a double-edged sword, and it judges our thoughts and the intents of our heart. So it's within that word that hopefully transforms us. But you remember we left off last week with the idea of, you know, how much we can love our children. And Jesus illustrated that in Scripture by telling them, you know, "Suffer not the little children to come unto me." And Jesus sat them on his lap and loved them and cared for them. And if we're honest, that's what we do with children, right? We love them for who they are. You know, I told you there last week, it's not like someone has a baby and you look at it and say, "Well, that's one of the ugliest babies I've ever seen." It's just not what we do. We love them. If you've had children, you've loved them for who they are. And the idea would be is that, or for me, is that, you know, we love them, and as they grow up and as we give them advice, you know, loving them, trying to keep them from making the same mistakes that we made, that they would just simply listen, right, and love us back. But how does that work? If we love children, do they just automatically grow up and they're exactly who maybe we want them to be, or more than that, God, who God wants them to be? Is loving them enough? And the answer is what? No. But shouldn't it be? If there again, if we just love them and teach them hopefully the right things and they love us back, that should be enough. But we discover, because we've all been a child at some point and some time, is most generally, and I'm not saying this is 100%, but most of the time we have to learn what? Maybe not learn to fall, but fall in order to get up, right? It's like riding a bicycle for a parent. I remember teaching Lee and Rachel to ride, and you know, Jamie was there with us, and you know, you can love them, And you can try to protect them and whatever else, but what has to happen at some point? They got to wreck the bike, right? You know? And maybe I can try this out with my grandkids if I ever have any grandkids. Maybe just make them wreck the bike to begin with, right? So you know, you wreck the bike and you kind of put it all together then, and hopefully you can cruise on down the road at some point. But for children, and not only for children, I think most generally we have to fall to realize that, you know, what it means to get back up. And even with the bicycle thing, it's a continuing thing, because, you know, you as a parent, you're saying, you know, hey, be careful. You know, don't go too fast. So, you know, we wreck it and learn how to ride it, but then when we get confidence, and, you know, we go down this hill and we get pretty fast, and we go down the next hill and we get a little bit faster. And in the back of our mind, we're remembering, right, that our parents said, you know, don't go too fast, but they don't know what they're talking about, right? So how fast can we go? And if any of you have ever been on a bicycle or a motorcycle and it gets into what they call a speed wobble, you're done for, right? When you get going that fast, and I don't know how to explain it, but I know some of you are shaking your head, so you all have done it too. You get in that speed wobble and crash city's coming. Hopefully, when that happens, we learn from that mistake. And I believe it's the same way with God. We know that God loves us. The world, if nothing else, should know John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. We should know that. And we, especially as the church today, should know that God loves us and cares for us. And in all honesty, that should be enough. It should be enough just simply for us to know that we're loved, and simply to love God back, and then do this thing called life. And I really don't like saying what I'm about to say, but you'd have to do a lot of convincing to get me to go the other direction. I believe even when it comes to our relationship with Christ, we gotta fall. There has to be some type of something, whatever that something is. We have to fall in order to really realize that God loves us. I'm not going to say that's 100%, but generally we have to fall in order to recognize that God loves us and that God is the only one who can set us back up on our feet. But how often as the church have we forgotten about who we are? How often have we forgotten about who God wants us to be? Now, I'm not being critical of Walnut Street, or if you're joining us online, I'm not being critical of your church, but I think far too often the church has become our own social club that we become a part of, and sometimes we look at it, well, you know, I'm in, and, you know, Linda doesn't come, so Linda's out. or I'm right, and, you know, I used that illustration a while back, but our church is right, and Roger, you're just a lost cause. And we do that. And I somewhat get it at times, but still, we're not living into the simple fact of who we are. Because I want you to think about today the times that you've fallen and about the times that you've had to get back up. I want you to remember that, you know, we've all fallen. Scripture says that we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. And to illustrate that, you remember last week we had, per se, what we called the good list and the bad list from Colossians? Well, Scripture, being sharper as a double-edged sword, you can go to many different places, but I begin to think about how God has worked in my life and the times that I've fallen. And I went to Galatians, and I'm going to start at chapter 5 and verse 19. But it says, now the works of the flesh is this. Very similar to what we read from Colossians last week, but the works are evident. Sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. So that's one list. And then we come down in verse 22 and 23, and the fruits of the Spirit are what? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. So, if we look at these lists, right? And if we as the church today say that, you know, God loves us and we're loving God back, right? That's kind of what we're putting out there, right? If that's who we are, that means every one of us can say with 100% that this past week that we've lived with love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, right? That's us. Now, how many of us did that? You know, I gave you the poll last week, but we're kind of playing off that. That's how we should live. But let's be honest, as the church, we still have this other list, right? Sexual immorality, idolatry, sensuality, impurity, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions. That probably, those three really hit the church, right? Rivalries, dissensions, divisions. Very characteristic of the church, right? Think about it. Think about over the years that you've been in the church, how many times has there been rivalries and dissensions and divisions? Well, the reason I say that to you today is the simple fact is it's easy to forget. It's easy to forget who you are. It's easy to forget, you know, where you came from. You know, you hear that's some advice, right, for people that love us, don't ever forget where you came from. We're all sinners. And the church should never become a place where it's us against them. We have to recognize our own failures. And to understand that maybe, and maybe it's not even, aren't we all addicted? Aren't we all addicted to something? You know, I looked at, and you could actually preach the 12 steps, but step one of the 12 steps in AA says, we admit that we are powerless over alcohol, that our lives had become unmanageable. How many of us could say the same thing? We could take that list, and how many of us can say that our lives are powerful, are powerless over this situation? And that's the truth. Because whatever you're addicted to, you are powerless. It could be anger, it could be dissension, it could be enmity, rivalry, whatever the case may be, it just because it's not alcohol or drugs doesn't get you and I off the hook, does it? We all struggle. And as the church, we need to have that understanding. Hey, we none of us are perfect. I think that's what transforms us. That's what changes us. But not only does it change us, but I think that's what changes the world in which we live. But so often, you know, we say, well, you know, if you have an issue with anger or whatever it might be, you say, well, I'll just fix it myself, right? How's that going for you? Your struggle this morning, how's it going for you? If you've decided, hey, I'm going to fix this. I know we laugh and we joke about it, but I've said it's about, you know, it's like for myself, it was that easy. I'd go one or two ways. I'd either lose a bunch of weight, or I've always said this, if I was about 6'8" and spread this out a little bit, I'd be pretty thin. Right? But it's not that easy. And my struggles in life are not that easy, and I have to come to an understanding that I cannot fix myself. You know, I didn't quote this the other week, but it came to me, but I go back to Luke chapter 11, starting at verse 24, but it says this, when the unclean spirit has gone out of a person, it passes through waterless places seeking rest and finding none. It says, I will return to my house from which I came, and when it comes, it finds the house swept and put in order. Then it goes and brings seven other spirits more evil than itself, and they enter in and dwell there. And the last state of that person is worse than the first. That's what happens when we start trying to fix ourselves, right? It's what happens. I think, and it goes back, I have lost weight, and it is possible. But, you know, how many of us try these, I guess what they call these fad diets, and you go on it and it really works. But what happens when you quit? Right? Back up our roof we go. And in one sense, we're worse off then than what we were in the beginning, right? And the same thing holds true as the church. When we have this idea that we can fix ourselves and we cast that unclean spirit out and we sweep and we clean and everything's going fine, and then we stumble, we fall, and we discover that last state, we're a whole lot worse off than what we were in the beginning. So acknowledging that we're powerless over our addiction or and whatever it is, and we have to recognize that our only hope today is in Jesus Christ. And that hope comes from the fact that, you know, said there in verse 15, it says, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin." Jesus knows what we're going through. Jesus knows what we're facing. And we have to recognize the fact that we need to approach grace, approach Christ. And as we approach Christ, we find that grace and we find that mercy. That's transformation. You know, I grew up, much of my life I grew up with, you know, you were expected to do this, and if you didn't do this, there were consequences. You know, there was some punishment of some kind. Sometimes maybe harsher than others, but still a punishment. And I've done a lot of things in life that probably, in all honesty, should have been beaten into an inch of my life, to be honest. But typically, during some of my failures, and you got to get this, I'm just now getting to a place in life that I can see it this way. But I remember it was my senior year in high school, and we had gone to a football game or a basketball game up in Nicholas County, and we stayed longer than we should have stayed. My guess would be probably girls, that's just me. But my friends had a curfew, I told them, "Oh, don't worry, we can stay. I can drive fast enough to get you home." So we stayed, and I was going way, way too fast. And I'd always heard my dad say, he said that most generally, anytime anyone ever wrecks, it's because they're going too fast. There's a whole lot of truth to that. But I was going too fast. Matter of fact, I was going fast enough that we should have been killed. But long story short, probably couldn't have wrecked the car any easier than what it did. But there again, we were lucky. Matter of fact, car went over in the ditch, and you can call me lying or not, but the left driver's side wheel on the back, it was sitting at least this far up off the ground where it was sitting over the ditch. And I was mad. I was mad because I'd wrecked, but I was madder because I knew we were in trouble. And I wasn't drinking, but the boys with me were drinking. But when you're driving probably 100 mile an hour and going in a ditch, you talk about some other boys that got sober real quick. They did. But they said, "Oh, Mike, it'll back up out of there." And I said, "No way, we're in trouble." But I got in the car, and you know that car backed up out of that ditch just as slick as it could. We went on down the road. Like I say, we were almost at my house. And as we were on our way, we actually met the man with the blinking blue lights. And needless to say, I didn't go back to see what they wanted. But I went in, and it was late at night, so I didn't want to wake up Mom and Dad, so I left them a note and told them I'd wrecked the car. Well, needless to say, I was up rather early the next morning, and I remember sitting there at the coffee table with Mom and Dad, and here I am ashamed. I knew that I'd done something I shouldn't have done, and part of me was ready to face whatever punishment was. But as I sat there that morning and we talked, all it really came out of that conversation that I remember is that how disappointed. How disappointed they were in me. I could have handled a paddle. But knowing that I disappointed them. Now I'll be honest, that didn't change me all at once, but I realized that morning, you know, regardless of my faults and regardless of my failures, that, you know, I had a mom and dad that still loved me. Now, I get it, they didn't approve. They did not approve with what I'd done, but, you know, they loved me. And see, I keep playing off this idea, you know, as the church, we're all sinners, we all fall short, we're all addicted, and we all need grace and mercy. You know, I picked up on that, well, I don't know that I picked up on it, I noticed it this go around. You remember the Old Testament? You had the Ark of the Covenant and then the two cherubim. You know what was the top? What was on top of the Ark of the Covenant? What was the lid called? Anybody know?
Mercy seat.
We forget that sometimes, don't we, Roger? If you didn't hear, Roger, it's a mercy seat. Aren't we encouraged here to come boldly before the throne of grace that we might receive mercy and grace to help in the time of need? That's transformation. And when you and I as a church realize how much we're loved by God, and we confess our sins to God, and James says that we need to confess our sins to one another, when we can sit down at the table and look into each other's eyes, that's what people need. There are people today that are hurting and broken everywhere, and yet the church has created this idea that it's us against them, that we're in, they're out. Why would they want to come today? But when they can discover that we love them, and that we can look into their eyes, and truly love, because I thought about that this week. In John chapter 20 and verse 23, it says, if you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld. Jesus has just appeared to the disciple. He's breathed upon them the Holy Spirit. And yet we get these verses. And it's easy, I think, to struggle with these verses. But isn't that not that we can forgive sin? Jesus Christ is the only one that can forgive. But when you can sit down with somebody and look in their eyes, that's what I found with my mom and dad that morning as we sat there at the table. I found forgiveness. And as I found their forgiveness, I began to realize, hey, they're not as crazy as I thought they were. Doesn't that hold true with God? We're forgiven. If David's struggling, instead of condemning David, why aren't we there to support David? To love him. And to let him know that we care for him. That's transformation. I'm closing this morning with a quote from Richard Rohr. I've used this quite often in the past year, but Richard Rohr says this: God does not love us if we change. God loves us so we can change. Did you hear what those were? If you didn't hear anything else this morning, I want you to hear these words. God does not love you today if you change. And unfortunately, that's what many churches preach. I've preached it. That's why when you go visit people, they'll say, well, you know, I'll be there when I get straightened up. Well, guess what? They never show up. Why? Because they can't get straightened up. God does not love us if we change. God loves us so we can change. That's transformation. And my prayer for you, even this day, would be allow God to transform you. Allow God to allow us to be the church that He wants us to be. We live in a world where people are dying without Jesus Christ. That's a simple fact. And we're called to be disciples. We're called to love God, and we're called to love others. That's our challenge. That's transformation. So as Elsie comes this morning and brings us a song, I don't know where you stand with God, but if you need prayer, I'll pray with you. If you need a church to pray, we can. I just want you to feel free this morning. What do you have, Elsie?
292.
292? All right. Our benediction. Go and follow Jesus on the pathway of love. Share the good news of mercy and grace. I think this is a challenging statement. Dare to let go. Find the courage and see what adventures God has in store for you. May the blessing of the Holy One give you courage, for with God, nothing is impossible. Amen.